everybody, and welcome to the Warhammer Community Podcast. I'm Wade Price, and delighted as ever to be joined once more by Phil Kelly. How are you,
Hello.
Phil? In front of your studious librarian. Fine set of books you have there behind you.
Yeah, yes, indeed. I need to get another bookshelf, actually, because I have a bunch of, you know, that crime where you stack up your books horizontally. I have about, looking up there, kind of probably nearing 100 of those, so I really ought to just bite the bullet and go to IKEA at some point or order something in. Mm-hmm. But yes,
I have a couple of flat-packed bookshelves on the floor just behind my screen and another cabinet like the one next to me, because I have also been filling up with stuff over the course of the lockdown.
Good man.
Right, but that's not what we're here to talk about. We're going to talk today about the new battle tome for Warhammer Age of Sigmar, Sons of Behemat. And this is very exciting. We've had the opportunity to talk to you about quite a few of the newly released battle tomes as new factions have made their way into the Mortal Realms. We've had the opportunity to listen to the wonderful Phil Kelly telling us all about them. So no change there. What would you like to tell us about Sons of Behemat, Phil? What is all this?
Okay, so, well, last time I was here, I was talking about Lumineth Realm Lords. My job is that I get to come up with background for the models that the miniatures designers make. And sometimes we get lucky enough in my department to make up whole ranges, whole races, whole worlds of information, which obviously give us a chance to shine a spotlight in a different part of the Mortal Realms. So for the Lumineth Realm Lords, obviously, we talked about the Realm of Lights, which is where they hail from, Hish. Whereas the Sons of Behemat are from Gur, which is the Realm of Beasts, which is a far more primordial, predatory land. Lots of things beginning with P. And it's, you really are either eating or being eaten in Gur. So the Sons of Behemat, the Gargants of Age of Sigmar, they love it there. They fit right in. kind of slightly kind of caveman primordial vibes of that place. They really are well suited to it. So we won't just be talking about the Gargants and the Mega Gargants. We'll also be talking a bit about the Realm of Beasts and how that works. But then essentially the history of Age of Sigmar that has brought us to the current day and how that applies to 60-foot eating machines that trample everything in their path.
So about a year ago, we saw the release of the Ogre Moor Tribes battle tome, and that gave us a bit of an insight into some of the dealings of the goings-on in Gur, because there's not a lot of written records from the people in Gur, because Gur's trying to eat them, or they're trying to eat other things an awful lot of the time. So to get a sense of that, some of the oral traditions that the ogres have passed on, or their understandings of the realm that they exist in and the mythology, I guess they're the wider than usual inhabitants of that realm, and now you've got the opportunity to look down upon the realm from that lofty perspective of the Gargants.
Absolutely, yeah. Well, we've been into Gur a little bit before, I should say. We know what it is. There's some information about it in the core rulebook, and then Ogre Moor tribes, but we haven't really kind of seen it mapped out until Sons of Behemat. So there's a double-page spread of a map of the Gurish heartlands and the different continents that make up that area, which are busy trying to crunch into each other and break each other apart and eat each other and overlap each other, because even the continents are trying to eat things in Gur, which is the kind of, I suppose that's the sort of the real archetypal feature of this land, is that, you know, even the trees are trying to eat the rock, the rocks are trying to crush the moss, the algae is trying to choke the river is trying to burrow through the mountain. Everything is preying and is on the rob in some form. So yeah, essentially, it's you can't sit still there for long. As you were saying about like people sitting still long enough to write things in Gur, like if you picked a quill like a feather and you started to scratch some ink, then maybe suddenly out of the feather come loads of little grubs that burrow into your hand, and you're like, oh god, you really don't get much time to just chill and write a book in Gur or illustrate a manuscript. Something's going to be biting your leg before you know it. And they've very much got this culture of might makes right, which we saw in the Ogre Kingdom, in the Ogre Moor Tribes book, and Sons of Behemat, as we know, mightier makes rightier, because they're even bigger and stronger. So that's Jervis's jokes. I just thought it was so good that I remember Jervis saying, can we get away with mightier makes rightier? Definitely could put that in, because that is absolutely the sort of Gargant sort of mindset. They are the kings of their worlds. Unfortunately, they're not very intelligent, and they often get people used to run rings around these, you know, the the Ale Guzzler Gargants that we know of old. So they're the ones that we've met through Oryx and Grots. They're often inebriated or hungover or sleepy or not really paying attention. They're actually quite easy to outwit. So in that way, they have a lot to do with sort of the fairy tale myth of a huge dim-witted gargant or giant. But as we know, these ones have definitely started to get their act together and are on the warpath. So Sons of Behemat is the story about when the gargants strike back, when they, you know, they're incensed now, they're angry, their forefather, their god beast father has been slain, whether he's actually their father or not. We'll come to that later. But yeah, they are very much incensed and they want to break and smash everything that's brought woe to their race.
I was just looking over the frontispiece, the first page of text in the battle time, and it finishes with "The gargant of the past is dead. Now come the sons of Behemat." Yeah. And they are strength incarnate. So what is different now in gargant culture? What's changed?
Oh, wow. Okay, so what we've got now is we've been through the Realmgate Wars period in Age of Sigmar. So Age of Sigmar has got three different eras, the Age of Myth, the Age of Chaos, and the Age of Sigmar, for which it is named. And the first bit of the Age of Sigmar was kicked off by the Realmgate Wars. Realmgate Wars were the first wars we really focused on in Age of Sigmar, and they were spread across a large swathe of like a year-long sort of set of books. And in that set of books, we had a book called God Beasts, in which we saw Behemat himself nearly awoken from his slumbers. Well, he was awoken. So the story goes that Behemat, a God Beast, which is a ridiculously titanic monster, he's so big that his knuckles are a mountain range, kind of, you know, he can crush mountains with his hands. He is vast. And he was happily stomping around the mortal realms. And if you look back in time, like, you can see that there's a connection between Behemat, the super giant, and Gorka Morka, who our greenskin players will be well aware of. Gorka Morka, the bellicose, primal, shouting god of the Oryx and the Grots, who's two-headed god. He's got sort of a Mork head and a Gork head. One is brutal but cunning, one is cunning but brutal. And he's an avatar of aggression and of uncomplicated violence, basically. He's not really in it to conquer this land or get that territory or put his flag anywhere. He kind of just wants to club stuff over the head just for the sake of it. So in that, he is an excellent patron for the Gargants and indeed for Behemat. So back in the Age of Myth, maybe even before, nobody was really counting at that point, those two got on like a house on fire. They really are, you know, kindred spirits. And Behemat was Gorkamorka's champion. However, events unfurled as Sigmar went around the mortal realms and started to unite his pantheon, Alariel and Nagash, Tirion and Teclis. He managed to free Gorkamorka from a kind of horrible amber prison, a living avalanche called Drakatoa. And unfortunately, this is like, you know, when you see an insect stuck in amber, like, this consumes Gorka Morka. He wasn't able to get out. He couldn't fight. Finally, he found an enemy he couldn't just bash. He got stuck in that amber avalanche, and he was imprisoned there. He, for all his bellowing and fighting, he just could not move. And it was Sigmar that broke him out, essentially smashed the avalanche with his hammer and the lightning of his pal Dracothian, another god beast. Dracothian is like the great drake, so a vast constellation dragon. And together they got rid of this horrible living avalanche, Drakatoa, and freed Gorka Morka. So Gorka Morka then has a kind of, essentially has a massive fight with Sigmar because he's still angry. And they come to a sort of an accord after 12 days of punching each other that maybe they should work together. And Gorka Morka goes off and he ends up essentially working for Sigmar. I mean, whisper it, because, you know, you don't want to say that in front of Gorka Morka. But he was killing all the monsters of the lands in order to make it safe for Sigmar civilizations to grow up. For a while, he was like, that's great, I love killing monsters. But the whispers of chaos said to him, you know, are you being Sigmar's puppet? Are you his slave? Are you doing his deeds? And Gorka Morka started to think, hang on a minute, am I being conned here? Am I being, you know, am I somebody's tool? And so he started to resent Behemat, who was happily wandering around with his head literally in the clouds, eating, sleeping, belching, eating some more without a care in the world. And so Gorka Morka started to challenge Behemat to essentially do the same things that he'd been doing. So this is how we get to the trials of Behemat, where he's posed these various mythical stories and mythical challenges that he has to achieve, which is a lot of fun. So in case you're not getting this, the history of the Sons of Behemat is very much about stories and tales and oral tradition and myth. They don't really even get it together to do any cave paintings. These guys are just telling each other stories. So whether they're true or not, whether Gorkamorka was really trapped in a living avalanche, or whether there really was a giant sky dragon that freed him, or whether he and Behemat went around putting mountains in on the top of volcanoes to stop them erupting, who knows if that's true? Nobody really. Maybe they are, maybe they aren't. But it doesn't really matter, because the Sons of Behemat think they're true, and it's driving them into this frenzy of activity, and they're trying to essentially do their forefathers proud, just as Behemat tried to do Gorkamorka proud, and his sire Imnog. The Gargants of today are trying to up their game ever since the death of Behemat, which we'll talk about in a bit. So that's the difference, Wade, really. They are on the warpath, and they're very much trying to show off, trying to be the next Behemat, I suppose you could say.
Mm-hmm. So that's the role of the mega gargants, the gargants that are larger than any that we've seen striding around the realms before.
That's right. Yeah, which is a great reason why, we brought out this absolutely stunning kit. It's just, you have to see one in the flesh, as it were, to appreciate just what presence these models have on the table and what beauty there is in that model. You have to turn it around in your hand and really sort of feel the heft of it to realize that this is a just massive model. And it comes in. It's incredible that the sculptors can do this, but they can, just from the one kit, you get three very distinct looking gargants or mega gargants. Looking on the website, just marveling at how different those three look. And it might be just a turn in the torso, or like a tilt of the head, or a few different, arms and a different silhouette, but they just look very different from each other, which I think leads you to thinking, well, I've got to get all three and then put in some man crushes and then have like a proper army of gargants where nothing is the same as another one. That's kind of what we're hoping people will do.
So yeah. As well as considering the mythology and the cultures that the gargants have and the beliefs that they have, you've had to consider what armies of them are like compared to other armies of the mortal realms, because they've been of a similar sort of type and height and form so far. But you've got to, I guess, scale up the thinking of what those forces are up to and what they're capable of achieving.
Yes, indeed. Well, as I say, they are quite different. When the gargants of old was almost like solitary creatures, they just, they're happy to sit in their cave picking their toenails and eating random bones and livestock. Raiding inns and taverns, and they didn't, they're quite aimless. I think that the gargants of yesteryear, they don't really have a driving force or an agenda of any kind other than like eat, drink, sleep, repeat as necessary. But now that these guys are, there's definitely a sort of the sap is rising, the surge is a surge of energy in the Sons of Behemat, in the whole gargant race. Some of them are getting bigger and bigger and bigger, and the mega gargants are a part of that. In the background, I'm sure there are gargants that are even larger than that. Look at the bone grinder, for example. There are some that are probably twice the size or even three times the size of those guys, well on the way to becoming world titans like Behemat himself. Because that role has to be filled by somebody. The role of world titan of supergiants is there in the Age of Sigmar. And yeah, they all want to be the next one to do their dad proud, essentially. So that's an incentive for these guys to go out there and eat more, fight more, prove their might. And every time you see a mega gargant stomping his way across the mortal realms, it's quite inspiring for the ale guzzlers of old, for the normal gargants. They see one of those and they're like, oh, okay, I might be big, but he is colossal. That guy is enormous. So I'm going to follow him. Again, a might makes right kind of scenario there. It doesn't really matter if that mega gargant is particularly intelligent or is a great strategist. They'll follow him because he's huge. And they do so. It's quite easy to follow a mega gargant. They leave these massive footprints everywhere they go, make a hell of a racket. So you just have to follow the trail. That's something that's quite interesting about gargants is they're a lot of their worldview, a lot of their kind of their totems and their icons come from feet. So I see these huge footprints. When they see Gorkamorka manifesting as a great green foot to stamp on the enemy, which is an auric spell, but they see that and they're like, yeah, see? Gorkamorka is a giant foot. He's the great stomper, the god stomper. He has a stompy but kicky foot and a kicky but stompy foot. So they very much believe that Gorka Morka is, again, is something that's so massive that he will tread on you. And that's, I think that's probably part of why they have this kind of like connection, is that when they tread on the enemy army, it's described in one of the captions as being a bit like treading on an orchard full of rotten apples, squishing and, you know, through your feet and through your toes. They have this sense of like invulnerability and power. So anything that could do that to them, they're like, that is definitely worth worship. That's their relationship. It's no more complicated than that.
Yeah, they're not really going to be subjects to too many predators, you'd imagine. Out in the wilds of Gur, they're pretty much the top of their food chain. Everything is on the food chain if they're suitably hungry and below them. But something that can actually inflict harm on them, certainly worthy of worship.
I think they're probably, this is an interesting point. That food chain is always moving in Gur, and they would be the top of their food chain in their environment, I think. But now they're on the move. They may even come up against things that are bigger and nastier than them. So Kraken Eaters are a good example. Like they literally will delve into the oceans of Gur and swim around trying to wrestle whales and kraken and oceanic beasts. Kraken, I say. And I love this notion. Like, this is one of the things that came up quite early in the project, that you would get these vast sort of mega squid kraken with all their tentacles tied into knots. As if somebody used to prognose them to stop them from getting strangled. And then huge teeth marks, like human teeth, but, you know, big enough to chomp a small cottage, appearing in the flanks of these things, which is, of course, a riff on that, you know, the sperm whales that wash up on the beaches with the big sucker marks from giant squid, where, you know, there's sperm whales and giant squid fight in the depths of the ocean. How cool is that? How could we not riff on that? So the Kraken Eaters are, you know, they're down there in the blackness, pulling tentacles and biting off bits of squid and, you know, instant calamari. So they're it's even on the model, actually. You can see like one of these great tentacles hanging from the waist of the Kraken Eater. So that was quite good fun. And it's that kind of like macro legend that we wanted to play with. There are beasts out there, like, again, the kind of mantle around the neck of a Kraken Eater is like, it hints that there's this huge megalodon shark out there that they've presumably just gone snap, broken its jaw, and, you know, kept one as a souvenir. Quite like taking trophies, these lads.
Yeah. I love the idea of the notion that some of the mega gargants may be getting larger, but there's not any sort of accurate record keeping in Gur or amongst the cultures that may see them, and many people who might experience such a beast are not necessarily going to survive to tell of it at all. So it does just foster more of that kind of mythology of, well, we haven't seen anything that big. Doesn't mean it isn't out there. It just means it's stomped everybody who might have been able to warn you about it.
Absolutely. If you look at the map of Gur, actually, there's one of these details you don't see immediately, but there are almost giant footprints across an area called Imnog's Trample, and they don't quite look like footprints. They look like they might be claws or weird talons, but they're there, and they cross that land as if some colossally massive creature has just thudded his way across the realm. And yeah, maybe they're lakes formed by some kind of geological quirk, but, you know, it's just as likely, if not more so, they are actually the footprints of a god beast of yore. So yeah, you've got this kind of wonderful grey area of whether it's real or not. And that kind of leads us back to the death of this poor benighted god beast. So essentially, Behemat, in his trials, he had all these various trials that he was trying to outdo his patron, Gorka Morka. For example, like Gorka Morka, at one point, he killed all the monsters in this desiccating desert in Hish. He was super thirsty, so he drank loads of the ocean. He drank so much of the ocean that it's going to cause the tide, and the backwash off of that actually ended up flooding an entire city and destroying a city. And Gorka Morka kind of challenged Behemat to replicate that task, which he managed by tripping over the wrinkly bits of a fjord. So he didn't really do it on purpose, but he kind of belly flopped, and then like the huge waves tsunamied an elven city. And ever since, the elves have like lived underwater, and this is how the gargants reckon it. So then when they see
it, makes sense. It all scans. Everything they say makes sense.
They see the Ardenesteek and they're like, yeah, that was because of that time that we flooded their city. Yeah. It's nothing to do with Snesh or Teclis or escaping any of that. They don't have no idea of any of that stuff. Completely oblivious. They think the dwarves or the Dwarden of the Fire Slayers are short because Behemat put a mountain on top of a volcano to stop it exploding. The Fire Slayers became very incensed. and Behemat had to stomp on them. And since then, Dwaldin have been short because he stomped on them. Again, it's almost certainly not true. In fact, it plainly isn't, because Dwaldin come from Grimnir and Grungni.
But so they say. But it all fits with the culture of kind of primitive people emerging from caves and seeing things for the first time and equating them to all that they know, which is essentially mightier makes rightier. And how can that be applied to everything they see in the mortal realms? And it can be applied. You just very simply apply that principle to it, and it all makes sense. I like that.
Yeah, this is kind of how a lot of cultures in history have seen the world and how the world operates. One of my personal favorites is the myth that the sun, essentially, you know, we didn't really understand that the Earth orbits the sun for a long time as a race. And yeah, they thought the sun was being pushed across the sky by a giant dung beetle that was rolling. It's an old Egyptian myth, rolling the sun across the sky. Or being drawn by a chariot, depending on, you know. So all of these kind of very far out myths that are actually from the history of planet Earth. It's the same principle, which is like somebody that doesn't really understand the mechanics of or the astrophysics or metaphysics in the Age of Sigmar is just going to come up with a story to explain it, and it doesn't have to be true, really.
There's a line that I like in particular at the end of the mythology in the Battletome that says, perhaps all of them are right, and perhaps none at all. And I think it feeds back into the point you made. What is important is they believe this. This is their belief, and this is why they are stomping around looking to prove themselves over their others or to their forefathers. It doesn't really matter if it's true or not. You couldn't reason with them to say, this is not actually how the world came to be. You don't need to be like this. They're on this course now. This is the course of the Mega Gargants and the Sons of Behemat.
They would just eat you, wouldn't they, if you were trying to explain anything to them? They'd just be like, what not a chomp. Yeah, so you've got the events essentially of these challenges led to a final challenge where Sigmar said to Behemat, if you're so great, then you must fight Sigmar, the hammer god, the warrior god, the storm god. I fought him for 12 days, so now you have to fight him. And, well, it wasn't a draw this time. Sigmar is able to call on great power, of the power of the heavens, essentially an entire realm of magic, and he managed to smite Behemat so mightily on the jaw with Galmaraz that Behemat essentially fell after disgorging a bunch of gargants in one great heave of procreation before he died. He collapsed and slammed down into the earth of Gairan. The scabrous sprawl formed over the top of him, and he essentially went into a kind of like a comatose state and was only roused by Archaon. Archaon has like found out about the god beasts, and he thought, well, I can use these to attack Azir. Who wouldn't want a mountain smashing super gargant on their side? So he charged the Skaven with drilling down with their parasite engines into the deep, deep earth to wake him up and poison him and cause him to essentially go into a frenzy. And it worked. Behemat did start to wake and shudder and crack the ground and crevasses opening as he's lifting these great arms that are, you know, the size of an entire nation. And he was getting up, actually, you know, polluted by the plagues of Nurgle and by the warpstone of the Skaven, and he was becoming a kind of like a horrendous evil version of himself. So much so that Alariel basically said, well, he's beyond saving. We have to kill him, even though he's not evil. He's just like an elemental force. And the Stormcast Eternals, Celestin Prime, they delivered the death blow using these 12 bolts of lightning, and they killed Behemat. And that was a great act that resonated through the cosmos. And ever since then, the Gargants have been like, right, team order is going down. They're like, nobody kills our dad and gets away with it. So they definitely want to smash cities and tear apart civilizations, as typified by the Gatebreaker, of course.
Is there any amount of Sigmar or any elements in Azir who might look to any of these rising Mega Gargants in the hope that maybe they could trammel it and contain it in the manner that Sigmar had kept Behemat in line?
So there are, don't get me wrong, I've kind of painted them all in the same way here as sort of really destructive primal creatures, but there are some that have adapted to the different realms, or even some that are quite intelligent. So they're outliers. They're definitely on the tiny thin ends of the bell curve. But there are gargants out there who are like shadow gargants who have adapted to Ulgu, or swathed in weird, black, oily, inky matter around them. There are Mason Gargants up in Azir, who are full. There's even one in described in the Soul Wars box set, who is a saint of the Sigmarite Church. There are Gargants who have become Sigmarite and started to worship the God King. And I like the idea of these great Mason Gargants, like they're essentially the cranes of the operation or the wrecking balls, you know, building these huge things in Azir. So yeah, there are good guy Gargants, for want of a better term. Those that work with Team Order. Of course, there are a great many mercenaries out there. So Gargants, kind of Mega Gargants, even learned from their Ogor pals. So Ogors and Gargants are quite simpatico. They work together. And they learned from the Ogors that you can actually get more stuff if you essentially make a bargain with the tiny little squeaking thin ones that run around the place. They will literally bring you food. If you just do what you were going to do anyway, which is just break stuff, and they just make sure that you break the same stuff that they want you to, and then they bring you food and ale, and this can happen indefinitely. And that's known as the great secret, essentially. When the Gargants found that out, it's like, wow, okay, this is cool, actually. Not to say that any of these are like contracts. It's not like the Gargant is like putting his fingerprint on a massive, you know, parchment contract. He might go back on his word at any time. It's a Gargant. What are you going to do? If he gets annoyed or just didn't really pay attention, he's stamping on your handgunners instead of like the enemy warriors. Well, they're all small, aren't they? You know, you're a Gargant.
If you wanted to keep the Gargant in line, you needed a mightier Gargant, because mightier makes rightier. And if you had that, then you wouldn't have had a problem. But you didn't.
Indeed. I like the idea that the paymasters and commanders that get these mercenaries, they have to stand, like climb up on top of a church or a temple or something really high to like be at least eye level with the Gargant before he will listen to you. Because again, it's, why would he listen to an insect? It's like if a little beetle came up to you, Wade, and went, you'd be like, okay, anyway. Just ignore it.
Yeah. But if a beetle hovered around my eye and gained my attention, I would be intrigued. That would be unusual. I'd have to give it at least a moment's notice. Yeah.
And possibly swat it, depending on your mood. But let it out the window, I suppose. But yeah, the Gargants are more like, you know, they're very impulsive, unpredictable. That's something we've tried to get across in the rules and the way they play on the tabletop. Something that's always been the case for Gargants is that they are, they just do whatever enters their minds at any one point. Sometimes they're devastatingly effective. Sometimes they might just get completely preoccupied by picking up a certain dude and sticking him in their bag for later because he had a shiny hat. So, you know, they're really completely laws unto themselves. I think that's part of their charm, actually, is that they are very anarchic, unpredictable creatures.
Yeah, certainly the kind of legacy of Warhammer Giants, as was, they'd have all sorts of exciting things that they could do on the tabletop to represent that. What has my model decided to do right now? And I'm going to enjoy this experience. I like to think that this is carried through to the Sons of Behemat Battletome as well.
Yeah, it really is. Yeah, we tried our best to keep a lot of those notions alive. Jervis and I talked about it a lot and how to, you know, obviously the Kraken Eater has got a huge net bag. He's going to be stuffing people in that bag. So we made a rule for that to happen. But the fact that they pick people up and not only like sometimes they just chomp them, but sometimes they throw them as well. For Gargants, battle is recreation. They think it's tremendous fun, especially Mega Gargants. It's a great chance to show how big and tough they are, how, you know, they can storm through a regiment of swordsmen with like a few scratches, but no big deal. So it's a real thrill for them. But it's also kind of like an extreme sport, I think. You might get, you know, shot a few times, maybe take a cannonball or three, but, you know, them's the breaks. And they have the, you know, these different sort of Gargant sports or pastimes that are, it's a way of us sort of playing up that kind of irreverence, slightly silly nature of these guys. They might pick up a horse and like use it like a bowling ball to try and take out as many people as they can. Or, you know, they have these sort of stupid pastimes, like filling their mouths full of like boars and pigs to try and cram in as many in their mouth as they can, like more than the next guy. He's managed to get 15 boars in his mouth. Can this guy get up to 16? Picks them all out in a sort of squealing, oinking mass at the end of it. For them, that's just Tuesday, you know, it's because what else are they going to do? The idea of tipping steam tanks or like, you know, just
tipping stone horns.
Yeah, exactly. Pulling a Caradron frigate out of the sky and then lobbing it into a church. That's just that's the way they pass the time. So yeah, it's a joyous experience to watch a Gargant do his thing. Even when they die, it's funny because they fall over and squish stuff nearby. So yeah, I would definitely recommend them for a more light-hearted player, I think, as well as a bit of plain old brute force.
Is it a nice salve for you as well, coming out of the perspectives and the experiences of the Lumineth Realm Lords, who are burdened with all of the knowledge of how bad it is in the realms and what they face in chaos, and then to be able to literally get above all of that and have the Gargant's perspective of, it doesn't matter, the Age of Chaos, it's not really that much different from the Age of Sin. It's just the Age of Food, isn't it? From
Indeed.
It's all food.
Yeah, very much so. So obviously the Lumineth are like very kind of mythical, classical kind of feel to them. They're quite po-faced, actually. I think their culture and their empire is all about philosophy and learning, higher learning and higher thought. So to do something which is as basal and physical and slightly kind of juvenile, I suppose, as what these giants get up to is just, it's a lot of fun. I really got to explore that in the naming tables, actually. In the book, there's a bunch of tables as to how to generate the names and the demeanors of your Gargants. And that was tremendous fun to write that and sort of come up with 18 different versions of the Kraken Eater and you know, his friends, you know, different War Stomper and the Gatebreaker, the different kinds of Mega Gargant. And their personality trickles down into the Man Crushers that follow them. The Man Crushers hero worship the Mega Gargants and will ape them in battle and then fight in the same way, which is how the command abilities work. But yeah, essentially that was tremendous fun. But we also, interestingly, on those naming tables, we also wanted to include a little story that showed the horror side. Actually, a Mega Gargant to you and me is pretty amusing, but if you're in a battle line and it's coming towards you and you cannot battle is like an open plain, you're not going to escape it. It's going to get you. Mm-hmm. And it might just bite your head off or squish you in its hand like a grape. And that to a human, like in the Age of Sigmar, is obviously going to be terrifying on a very deep genetic level. So yeah, I think they are scary, and we tried to get that across as well. So there's both the humor and the lighthearted sort of goofing around jackass sports stuff, but then there's also the sheer terror of what would it be like to be trapped in a Kraken Eater's cave and the tide's coming in and you're in a cage and you can't get out, and sooner or later you're either going to drown or you're going to get eaten by this stinking great briny behemoth. So yeah, you're dead either way. And that kind of that terror of like, what are these things really like from a ground's eye view is something we tried to explore.
I think it's a point we'll probably make in some of the other podcasts about the Sons of Behemat, but the Destruction faction really does offer that opportunity to see the dark horror of Warhammer, as long as it's not happening to you. Because even back to the Gloomspite Gits, there's plenty of horror and kind of fairy tale, grimdark fairy tale horror in the Gloomspite Gits, but you wouldn't want it happening to you, to be swarmed by chittering, horrible, stinking things to drag you into the caves and the caverns. And the ogres have a similar sort of vibe, that a bit of might makes right, and they're chortling and they're quite jocular and use words like cove, and they've got a great little culture and a style. But yeah, the Gargants are a different remove entirely, something else altogether.
Yeah, absolutely. So yeah, I mean, this is the part of the fun, really. It was, as you say, a very different departure. I really love Destruction. I love the energy and the fun of it, out of all the Destruction races. I have painted many orcs, oryx, ogres, however you want to say it, like all of the different Destruction stuff over the years. I've been right up for that. So this is definitely a good excuse to write something a bit more rambunctious and come up with some fun terminology and there's definitely more jokes in Sons of Behemat than there are in Lumineth Realm Lords. Yeah.
And it's good to be able to step out of that, I think, to know that there are some combatants in the mortal realm still who aren't necessarily beset by all of the horrors of either the Lumineth Realm Lords or the common people of the free guild cities trying to eke out a living. So I imagine if you're from the realm of Gur, because I know I've seen that double page map that you talked about, and spotting Excelsis and the Talon Coast and some of the places we've seen or heard bits and pieces about in the realms already. There must be some inhabitants in Gur who have an understanding of Gargants and even larger Gargants. It's a bit of a feature. They're like natural disasters, or the Destruction factions. But these other Gargants in the other realms that you mentioned, might there be cultures who've kind of grown used to the Gargants that are now beginning to stir and finding that the Gargants of the other realms are picking up on these vibes going around the realms as well?
Definitely. I think regardless of realm, they're all on the rampage now. And yeah, you would have to learn how to deal with them. how to avoid them. I think the best strategy is just stay out of the way. You can see them a mile off. You can hear them coming. The best, like, you know, in the real life situation of Age of Sigmar, just avoid them. Just do not go near them. Don't try and bargain with them or reason with them. You know, even the old, so gargants and giants and ogres are all creatures that are from myth of right the way across the planet. Every culture has its own version of giants of some kind. And we grew up with them, didn't we? Jack and the Beanstalk and the stories of, you know, when we were kids. Mm. And I was thinking about Fee, Fi, Fo, Fum earlier on. And the next line is, I smell the blood of an Englishman, if memory serves.
Yeah.
But wait, so they're sniffing your blood. That's pretty disturbing. Great flaring, hairy nostrils as this thing is homing in on you. And like, it wants to grind your bones to make its bread. So they are already, even in the kind of the kids' stories that we have, they're already pretty scary things. And then when you transpose that to a war footing, these things love war, as I said, and they will follow the footsteps of an army. So you imagine an army marching through territory, regardless of realm, it's going to leave a big swathe of footprints and of waste and rubbish and just, you know, all the detritus of an army on the march, that, you know, even if it's only just a huge set of tracks. And when a mega gargant sees that on the ground, he follows it because he knows at the end of that trail are hundreds of warm bodies for him to eat. And maybe, just maybe, they will already be fighting another army, at which point, oh, it's bliss. Because he gets
a second course.
Yeah, exactly. Not only a second course, but he just gets to dive in like somebody cannonballing into a swimming pool of battle. He just gets to crash in there and just send horses and monsters and throttle a hydra, chuck it over your shoulder, kick a horse into a regiment, you know, knock a stone horn over for a laugh. They just have an absolute whale of a time. And we tried to get that across with the different, so the loathings, for example, for gatebreakers, the fact that certain, you know, mega gargants can actually interact with objectives in different ways and kick them and stuff. It's just tried to get that across that they are, they're just having fun, really.
Mm. You just happen to be on the battlefield where they're having fun.
Yeah,
that's you.
Get out of the way.
Yeah. So for each of the three named, or the three types of mega gargants in the battle tome, there's a named example, like an individual that represents their qualities. Can you tell us a bit about them?
Yeah, certainly can. So we've got good old Bundo Whalebiter is the kind of archetypal. It's just funny just to say that name, really. The archetypal Kraken Eater. He is. He's smarter than your average mega gargant, I'll tell you that much. He got a bit of a chip on his shoulder about Idoneth Deepkin raiding his sea caves and just generally taking control of the coast. And he doesn't like that. Kraken Eaters are very territorial. In fact, a lot of them are quite old. They're like elder gargants. They like going in the water, in the sea, because it takes the weight off their old bones and their knees aren't what they used to be and their hips are a bit dodgy. So go into the water, it's like, oh, that's much better. Yeah, you know, take the weight off. And so the Idoneth Deepkin are trying to claim that region. He decides he's had enough of it. And it goes off after them, swinging down into the depths. And then he loses them because, you know, good luck catching the Idoneth Deepkin. When they flee, when they decide to hide, they can hide from Teclis. So they're going to manage to hide from the Mega Gargant. But he does see this little glimmer of light, which is trailing off. So he goes after that and he catches it. So it turns out to be like an urn, a beautiful lantern urn strapped to a Fangmora. He said, oh, I'll have that from a treasure, which is exactly what the Idoneth wanted. They just wanted to lead him away so that he wouldn't bother them anymore. But he hung it next to his ear. And this urn, this sort of beautiful elven treasure, it actually has ether quartz inside it. It was a Lumineth artifact rather than an Idoneth. And it's increased his intelligence just by hanging next to his head. It's gradually made him brighter and brighter until that, you know, some say that he even reads these weird papery things that are in his, you know, turning over with a tiny stick to turn the page. He can read. That is a terrifying thought. It's like, this is a mega gargant that is quite switched on and has the same level of intelligence as a human. So, and possibly even some degree of magical ability as a result of this. That's something we put in as a little wrinkle in the rules as well. So that just occasionally you get a mega gargant who has some trinket or some sorcerous understanding of magic. So yeah, he's your kind of the brains of the operation, really, is Bundo. Then you've got One-Eyed Grunnock. One-Eyed Grunnock is the War Stomper archetype. He's the exemplar of the War Stompers. Massive flame-haired nutcase who's all anger and pain. All he wants to do is just crush things, jump up and down on them, as many as he can find. There's a story about this guy. Basically, there's in Gurish Necrosia, which is an Ossiarch Bone Reaper's claimed area in the Gurish Heartlands. There was a war between the Caradhron Overlords and the Ossiarch Bone Reapers that had just come to essentially a stalemate. And both sides, being quite legalistic and quite sort of contract-driven people, decided to make a treaty and say, right, enough's enough. Everyone's losing resources that we can't afford. So they're up on top of this great plateau, trying to broker a truce. I imagine, paragraph 17.9, subset B, you know, the Ossiarchs are like, yeah, let's see what you did there. But the legalistic sort of wrinkles of this contract, when one-eyed girl smashes his way into it, just destroys the whole, you know, he's climbed up onto the plateau just for the heck of it, really, and decides to smash everything. And after that, you know, the huge kind of confusion, anarchy of that war, there was no treaty to be had. There was no making any bargains or any contracts. All that's gone out the window. It was just battle, essentially. So those war stompers are a force of, you know, they're a catalyst for fighting, really, regardless of, you know, the context. And then you've got Big Drog Fort Kicker. So the Gatebreaker exemplar, horrible hooded nightmare of a thing. He's really a nasty piece of work, this one. And actually, he's got a secret agenda that he doesn't really tell anybody about. So this dude is, you know, he wants to break cities. One of the things that you find with these gatebreakers, they quite like working with undead. Sounds a bit weird. Why on earth would they do that? You don't want to be eating zombies and night haunts. There's nothing good there, no good meat. But if a night haunt or a zombie invasion floods, or a dead walker's flooding a city and they kill all of the people there, and off they go on to the next one. Often there is an entire city of corpses that are just waiting to be eaten. So the gatebreakers realize that actually you can get loads of plunder if you work with dead men, because the dead men don't really care about ale or food. They just, you know, a skeleton is going to go, oh, I'm just going to quickly have a stop for a bite to eat. So the gatebreakers get all of the spoils of war. They realize that they get all of the food and the trophies. Maybe the necromancers might want a few for to replenish their stocks, but yeah, they've figured out that actually working with the forces of death is a good way to get loads of plunder. And that's essentially what this guy, Big Drog, is trying to do, is like get in with the forces of death. But it's not just so he can get plunder. He's got a secret agenda, which is to essentially one day take out Nagash'azar, get to Nagash'azar itself and smash it up. That would be the greatest city, great death city. And if he manages to break that, then he'll be a legend forevermore. Unfortunately, you don't just even a mega gargant can't just attack Nagash'azar. It doesn't work like that. He may end up getting a bit too deathy for his own good. So I like the idea that essentially the gatebreakers are the ones that are most likely to become undead or lean towards undead and end up with horrible kind of pallor to their skin, and you know, maybe even fighting beyond the grave.
I can imagine that the Gargants might take an interest in the Ossiarch Bone Reapers for the purposes of grinding bones to make bread, if they don't need to get rid of the meat or anything. Already grinding.
You could get a whole lot of bread out of an Ossiarch host, couldn't you?
Something that we've seen as a feature of the most recent battle times, I guess all of the battle times, but something that stood out to me for some of the most recent ones. When the Ossiarch Bone Reapers were released, we and the inhabitants of the Mortal Realms found out, oh, didn't you know your bones are... you owe your bones. That's a resource. We're here to claim it. That wasn't really known about before, and that's a great spark and inspiration for battles to take place. And then the Lumineth Realm Lords came out to let everybody know, we need your land. We need to burn giant runes onto your farm. You need to get out of here. It's very important. And people maybe take issue with this. And now the Mega Gargants start wandering around. Everyone realizes we're all a resource as well. We're all food, and there's very little bargaining to be done. There's a lot of fighting that will need to be done. But yeah, war on a new scale for the Mortal Realms, I guess, because there's an entire army of Gargants coming at you where they might not have been before.
I think that's that revelation that you were saying about the about bone being a vital resource to this new race. And hey, you have bone. That kind of, oh, wait a minute. I think the Sons of Behemat version of that is, you know, you might be a powerful knight in shining armor, a beautiful plate mail with a crest and a heraldic and a magic sword. It means nothing. When these guys show up, a mega gargant, it's like, whatever, mate, just stomp on you, stomp you flat, no problem. You might maybe cut off a toe or a finger, you know, you might give them a nasty pinprick with your sword, Maybe a perfectly crafted spell might, you know, blast a crater in his hip, but ultimately he will get better, and he's got plenty more where that came from. So I think that sense that actually when you fight these things, there is a powerlessness and a kind of, you know, a very sort of deep lizard brain fear of like, that thing is massive. And that's essentially what we're trying to bring home. It's the destruction version of like super magic or amazing magic blade. Their version is, no, this one's really big. And his mates are even larger. You know, that's the way they escalate, and their kind of arms race is going, is just by having larger and larger gargants.
I think part of the horror that I feel with it as well, the same with the Ossiarch Bone Reapers, is you might be able to delay what's coming, but the tithe needs to be paid and gargants need to eat. Those are like death and taxes as the Ossiarch Bone Reapers, and gargants have to eat. It's a law of nature. They're going to eat something and somebody, and you can maybe delay them a little bit, but you can imagine cultures or people having to sell out their neighbors or betraying other armies to feed the gargants rather than be fed upon themselves. But the gargants are not going to stay fed for very long. Their stomachs are going to start rumbling again soon enough, and it's all going to kick off all over again.
Absolutely. Yeah, that's what we're trying to get across, is that sort of desperation. The mortal realms are awful places to be. You know, actually, I suppose Gur is probably one of the realms where the throttling stranglehold of chaos is actually a little looser, because it's just got, it's so unpredictable, and it has so many orcs, grots, ogres, gargants that, and you know, they're not going to take it lying down. They aren't going to go, okay, we're, you know, we'll just roll over. They're always up for a fight. So, but then again, living in, so if you lived in Gur, maybe you would have less blood reavers trying to eat your legs. But actually, you have to deal with ogres or with gargants instead. And is that any better? Probably not. You know, you might survive an extra day or two. So yeah, there's again, it's sort of like there are so many hazards and hostilities out there, and even Gur, which I think is one thing I like to think it's quite honest, really. You know, there's no sort of scheming or illusion or like manipulation. It's they're hungry and they want to eat you. It's nothing personal. You know, they're just, you're just food. Or you're annoying them by making a squeaking noise. It's not done on some sort of Machiavellian conquest, you know, or like they're not there around a war table going, oh, then we need a second flank opening here. They just want to eat. So yeah, they have a horror all of their own, but it's very, like I say, very honest horror, I think.
Yeah, if you are slow enough to be eaten by the trees or the rocks in the realm of Gur, you kind of had it coming. Yeah, they're not tricking you or betraying you. They, as you say, honestly, just the process of erosion or glaciers moving slightly faster than glaciers might be expected to move. But something's going to get you, and it was your fault for not keeping up, as you say.
Absolutely.
Honest approach. Yeah. Do you imagine you'll be adding any mercenary gargants of any persuasion?
I do have an Oryx army. Which I really enjoy, with loads of art boys, only not so many brutes, just because I love painting lots of models, and a big armored maw crusher, which I just stuck loads of gubbins on and bits of scrap metal. And I was saying to Jez yesterday, Jez Bickham, I'm going to definitely armor up a mega gargant and sort of give him a helmet of some kind. I'm not sure how, but I'll think of something. And then loads of shields and bits all across him, so he effectively becomes a rusty armored mega gargants. That has got to happen, and I'm really looking forward to that as a hobby project.
Yeah, your scrapper spill greenskins force is a beautiful thing to behold, but very rusty. I wouldn't like to get stabbed by it, but yeah, we've seen it on Warhammer TV and playing some games. I can imagine. I was trying to think of what would go well on that mega gargant. Maybe something, bits from the stomper kit. Could you get the stomper head as a helmet, an effigy of Gorka, Gork or Mork?
Black and iron, that might work. So yeah, I mean, this is part of the joy of being a hobbyist, is sort of coming out with all these different conversions and concepts. And I think that's one of the things that we will see a lot in the next sort of 6 months, 18 months, and for Golden Demon, is beautifully converted mega gargants. We've seen an awful lot of amazing, really top-end conversions just coming out of the Man Crusher gargants or the Ale Guzzler that are just astonishing. And some of the Golden Demon entries have to be seen to be believed. And that kit's beautiful. It's so versatile. But next to the Mega Gargant, I mean, it was made 15 years ago, I think. So, you know, you've got the even more of the sculptor's art in the Mega Gargants. And watching how people respond to that and make it their own is going to be a joy.
It does feel a little like the release of the Imperial Knight into the 40k ecosystem, where something of a completely different scale that became the building block of your army or the rank and file trooper of your army. And we started to see the conversion potential that that scale introduces, and seeing hobbyists introducing bits of scenery into their Imperial Knights to make more Questor Mechanicus looking knights. I'm looking forward to seeing people kitbashing some of the stuff that we don't often see introduced into miniatures because it might be a little bit too large, but some of the stuff that Gargants will look at and go, oh, big statue of Sigmar's head. Yeah, brilliant. I can use that. And stuff that we might not have seen before. It's going to be really exciting to see.
I can't wait. I think that, you know, much as I love Imperial Knights, they, for me, things that have faces have more character. And there's just, you know, these guys really ooze character, I think. And watching the way people paint those and bring them to life is going to be an absolute riot. And I don't think Age of Sigmar will ever be the same after this, because people will get used to seeing one or more of these Gargants stomping around on the battlefield. And they'll be like, okay, what do I do about the Mega Gargant? You will have to start to factor that into your play, into your army, into your selection, the way, you know, different scenarios. Every single scenario we've written, as soon as you put a Mega Gargant in there, is going to be a little bit different than how it was before, because they're, you know, essentially they do a lot through just sheer bulk. So a lot of things like mortal wounds, it's like, well, yeah, you can hit them with mortal wounds, but they've got 35 wounds or more. So, yeah, it's going to be good luck taking them down with zapping them a few times. This isn't a support hero. So, yeah, you're definitely going to have a different kind of looking at my Lumineth, actually, just in the corner of the room there, and thinking, right, how are we going to deal with the inevitable avalanche of flesh that is coming my way? And that's kind of fun, actually. I think, you know, coming up with this sort of, even if you're playing against them, it's fun to come up with the things from your battle tome that would excel in that situation. So I think there will be a real kind of a quake of a cause and effect going through Age of Sigmar from these guys.
Absolutely. And I'm looking forward to seeing players playing in character and loudly and belligerently insisting that they and their Mega Gargant are the next world's titan, and they will brook no disagreement from anybody. That'll be fun to listen to.
Just as long as they don't actually climb on the table themselves, I think, you know, that shouting, I'm a god beast, I think at that point you probably need to take them aside and have a word.
Well, perhaps all of them are right, and perhaps none at all. So how do the Sons of Behemat feature in the Soul Wars and the wider Warhammer Age of Sigmar narrative?
Okay, so the more up-to-date stuff where we've seen the Shaish Necroquake and the endless spells roiling across the place, that real upsurge of death and Grand Alliance death, they fit into that in a very interesting way, actually. So Sons of Behemat didn't really know, or they didn't really fear anything. I mean, these, why would they? They certainly didn't fear ghosts or bumps in the night, you know, the sort of traditional hot Halloween-y horror that we that we might see as spooky. They didn't even know the meaning of the word, really, until a certain Mortark came into play. So Lady Erlinda, so she is the kind of the high chief of the Nighthorn faction. She really is quite a scary lady, and she knows psychology, she knows terror and fear and how to get the most out of that. And when she ended up fighting a stomp of Gargant, so the collective noun is a stomp, whichever big heel is kind of the big heel is the leader of the stomp, and then under the heel are the other Mega Gargants, and then towing the line, see what we did there, are all the Man Crusher Gargants that are kind of the lesser versions, and they get bossed around a lot. And she came upon one of these stomps and decided to teach them a lesson, essentially, and teach them that they, you know, they should be afraid of Nagash and his will. And the way she did that was during a battle in a great chasm. It was going pretty well for the Gargants. The thing about Nighthorns is if you hit a Nighthorns and you really mean it, if you cut it in half and you've really got conviction and rage and courage, it will dissipate. But if you kind of go, oh, get off me, and poke it with a stick, it's going to destroy you, because it's the emotion behind the blow that kills it, not the actual sword. And the Gargants, well, they got plenty of confidence, plenty of power and emotion and rage. They were stomping ghosts left and right, you know, red blade harrow, squish, there goes a black coach, squish, until Lady Erlinda, in view, right on the wall of this chasm, in view of all of the other Gargants, touched their leader, and he just turned into a scattering of black roses that drifted down into the chasm. And the Gargants were like, wait, what?
That's weird.
At which point the banshees howl and scream in their ears and fly around their heads. And they start to go, you know, some of these Mega Gargants just died as a result and just fell over. There was no cut upon them, no blow, no cannonball. They just died. And that notion of like that, so suddenly that unease of like, hang on a minute, this is not natural, this isn't right, started to like flare in their minds. Even dim-witted brains of these Mega Gargants, they started to go, oh, okay, this is bad. And Alinda essentially unleashed her crap troops and beat them in this fight as a result, just from that seed of doubt and that seed of terror. But she let them escape. She let the last few Mega Gargants and Man Crushers run, howling from this chasm as it's filling up with ghosts and nasty energies and purple suns. Off they went. And as they ran to their tribes and ran across Gur, the word of this horrible massacre and of these new spooky, nasty ghosts started to spread from tribe to tribe. And yeah, it became like a campfire tale. It became something that, you know, the Gargants would use to scare each other with. And actually that seed of that story, that seed of doubt, has spread to such an extent that now the Nighthorns are seen as a formidable enemy. And only this has actually got to a critical mass, only the fact that the Mega Gargants started to fight alongside the Drakfoot. The Drakfoot are bone splitters. They're a type of Auruk who are, they go into battle nearly naked because they really believe in Gorkamorka. They don't need any of that armor nonsense. They just have war paint and self-belief. And again, that self-belief and that confidence makes them excellent at killing ghosts. They think they can kill Nighthorns, ergo, they can kill Nighthorns. And they became almost totemic to the Mega Gargants, who saw these, to them, quite small Auruks, you know, taking out ranks upon ranks of Chain Rasps and Dreadscythe Harridans, shouting jubilantly all the while. And they were like, hang on a minute, if they can do it, we can do it, right? So should we just paint ourselves with a bit of war paint and get stuck in? And hence the legend of Ghost Stomper was born, who is a Mega Gargant who's essentially decided to take the fight back to the Nighthaunt. So the Soul Wars have affected the Mega Gargants and the Sons of Behemat in a kind of very psychological way. It's a war of confidence and of self-belief. And whether they can overcome the Nighthaunt, who knows? But it'll be a lot of fun watching them try.
It's great to see that change in their culture, because I was reading the bit in the Battle Tome from the Age of Myth when Gorkamorka and Behemat were in a bit of an eating contest and they ate all the dead bodies of the monsters they'd slain, and then Behemat went into the underworld to eat their ghosts as well, just to make sure. So you can see that, yeah, surely the Gargants have no fear of ghosts. It's like a thing to wash down the main course. If you've still got a bit of room, nothing to be afraid of. But to see them experience how Lady Alinda, as the Mortark of Grief, could really actually make them quite terrified and present them with stuff they've not had to engage with before. Up until that point, mightier has always been rightier. There has never been any need to engage with anything other than that. But now there's stuff they don't understand, and small things seem to have some way of, this is all very peculiar altogether. So there's a bit of a journey for the Gargants to go on through this as well, it seems.
Absolutely, yeah. Nobody gets to have it their own way in Warhammer. Everybody's going to overcome obstacles and challenges. And the best stories are those where both sides come out looking interesting and cool. So yeah, well, hopefully that will be that'll spur people on when next time their destruction forces take on the forces of death.
Great stuff, Phil. Well, thank you very much for giving up more of your time to talk to us about the latest Age of Sigmar Battle Tome. It does sound very exciting. And as you say, it sounds like things will not be the same in the Mortal Realms after the Mega Gargants start stomping around.
Absolutely.
Thanks very much, everyone. Join us again next week for another episode of the Warhammer Community Podcast.